everyone. I'm Candace.
And I'm Arthur.
And I'm Vivian. And welcome to What's New with Microsoft 365 in September.
With Ignite happening last week, we wanted to do something different this month and recap some of the biggest news to come out of the conference.
We have so many great things to share with you all, like the general availability and tasks in Microsoft Teams.
What's new with Microsoft Endpoint Manager and the general availability of Endpoint Analytics.
Security updates for Microsoft Defender and Compliance Manager.
And so much more. Let's get started.
This first update is one that we know you've all been waiting for. And so that's why we're really excited to announce that Task in Teams is now generally available in the desktop app. This new task experience gives you one place to manage your plans and individual tasks.
The way this works is the Tasks app in Teams shows both Planner and To-Do. Tasks also appears as a tab, which is added to a Teams channel and only shows Planner tasks.
Some new additions you'll find in this app include task publishing, which lets companies create tasks at a corporate level and push those to targeted teams across their first line workforce.
As well as four views of your tasks, including the list view, as well as the board, charts, and schedule views from Planner.
And for IT admins in particular, there are now a few ways to manage the app for your organization, including the ability to enable or disable tasks in Teams for either your entire org or specific users, set a policy to automatically pin the Tasks app to the left side of Teams, and hiding the My Tasks lists for users.
To learn more about other features available for Tasks in Teams, check out the link in the description. We've also included a support page that goes into more detail about how IT admins can manage the app for their org.
With so many of us working from home these last few months, it's more important than ever to make sure that we can connect as organically as we can.
Together Mode is a new meeting experience in Teams that uses AI segmentation technology to digitally place participants in a shared background.
This makes meetings feel more engaging because you can see participants' faces and body language, making it easier to pick up on nonverbal cues that you don't always get from remote calls.
To make Together Mode even more exciting, there will soon be new Together Mode scenes, which will include an auditorium, a conference room, and a coffee shop background.
Presenters will be able to select a scene from the gallery as the default background for all meeting attendees. Together Mode scenes will be available later this year.
This next feature is another one that we're all excited to talk about, and that's breakout rooms, one of the most requested Teams features this year.
With breakout rooms, meeting organizers will be able to split up participants into smaller groups, which will make it easier to hold brainstorming sessions or work group discussions without cross-interference from other groups.
Presenters can then hop between and make announcements to all the breakout rooms and then close the rooms to return everyone to the main meeting. Breakout rooms will be coming soon.
We've talked about customization with the Together Mode scenes earlier, and soon, Teams users will be able to further customize their meetings with Teams meeting extensions.
With these new meeting extensions, users can now integrate their apps and create even more customized meeting experiences in Teams.
Meeting organizers can access the new extension from either App Source or from apps in Teams and add them as they schedule a meeting. These new extensions will move to general availability in October.
Later this year, IT admins will be able to customize their team's line of business app catalog using their organization's branding. This will enhance the experience for users and increase organic discovery and the use of an organization's line of business apps.
For admins deploying new Teams features, you may be happy to hear that Bulk Policy Assignment is now available.
While policies allow admins to control the Teams features available, now admins can apply policies in batches of up to 50,000 users. We've added a docs.com support page below to help you learn more on how to get started.
And in the last of our Teams admin news, we've improved the Teams Admin Center, which includes updates for device, app, and policy management. To explore more about what's new in the Teams Admin Center, we've added additional reading down below. Next up, we're lucky to bring on Senior Product Marketing Manager Mayank Jain on the show today.
Mayank's here to talk to us about some exciting news with Microsoft Endpoint Manager. Mayank, thanks so much for joining us on the show today. It's great to have you on again.
Thanks for having me, Vivian. It's so great to be back again.
There's so much happening with Endpoint Manager at Ignite this year. So let's start off with Microsoft Tunnel. What is it and how is it going to help our admins?
So the Tunnel is something that's been in private preview and we've seen tremendous customer feedback on it. What I'm excited to announce today is the public preview for Tunnel. And what it really allows you to do is give your iOS and Android users a way to access on-prem resources and apps. So this is very important now that we are working remotely. It allows them to take advantage of single sign-on with Azure Active Directory and then conditional access. In fact, we feel that conditional access with the Azure Active Directory is a key part of your zero trust security, and the Tunnel is integrated with that solution. The Tunnel for the end users is going to be like an app that appears on the App Store for the iOS or the Play Store for the Google ecosystem. And then you can onboard it from the Endpoint Manager Admin Center. So the IT can do that. They can do all the settings. So the onboarding is really seamless and easy for the end users.
That sounds like such an important feature, just given how remote our workforce is these days. Now, what can you tell us about being able to manage virtual endpoints?
Again, we come back to the whole remote work and how virtual desktops or Windows virtual desktops have saved us in the last 6 to 8 months. And the new thing that you'll be able to do now is manage those virtual machines using Microsoft Endpoint Manager. So as long as those machines are hybrid Azure AD joined, you can manage them through the Endpoint Manager Admin Center, just the same way as you would do any physical device. So from an IT person's point of view, it gives them an easier way to deploy. It gives them a better way to secure and then to really scale their management across their entire device estate. You know, whether it's mobile or physical or virtual, it's all going to be in one place, making their lives really simple. So this is going to be available for Windows 10 Enterprise desktops right away. And then support or public preview for Windows 10 Enterprise multi-session will be coming later this year.
And for our Mac admins, what's new in that space?
Some of the new capabilities include the ability to deploy scripts to devices or a new enrollment experience with single sign-on across apps. And then a new managed app lifecycle feature, which is coming from Apple. So this is a new managed apps feature coming in the next release of Mac OS that ensures not only ease of management, but also security. So for example, if a user unenrolls their Mac OS, and it used to be managed by Microsoft, all the apps that were deployed using the Microsoft Endpoint Manager will also be removed, you know, when the user leaves that ecosystem. In addition to that, we previously announced something called shared iPad support. So this is something that, Apple has introduced and we support, which is useful for people like in healthcare industry, where, you know, people can come in on different shifts, they can sign in, use the device, and then when they sign out, all their profile, all their data is removed or wiped clean to make the device ready for the next user. So again, it's super secure and the manageability becomes easier. So you can find information on our product docs for it.
So I know you spoke a little bit to this already, but just for clarity, can you talk about what's the timeline and availability for all of these features?
So a lot of these features, like I said, are going to be in public preview in this quarter. So you can find out the details in our blogs, which are at aka.ms/msendpointblog. So that's where we post the latest and the greatest. Being a cloud service, you can imagine that we don't have these, you know, yearly releases anymore. They're pretty much releasing something every 2 weeks. So we've got the website where we post these changes as they come around at aka.ms/intune new. And, you know, on the top, it says how many minutes it takes you to read. I think currently it's something like 59 minutes or something. So you can imagine how many new things are there. And they're just going to keep happening this quarter.
And finally, we hear that Endpoint Analytics and Productivity Score has now moved to general availability. Can you speak to that a bit?
Oh, absolutely. It's one of my favorite features. And I'm really happy that Endpoint Analytics is now generally available. Again, going back to that notion of us all working remotely, one thing that IT admins really need right now is visibility into their end users' device health and just issues or troubleshooting issues that they may be having before they have them. Because in any help desk ticket is really expensive and we want to minimize the number of help desk tickets, especially remote ones that are being generated, right? People can't just walk up to a help desk anymore. So Endpoint Analytics is a feature of Microsoft Endpoint Manager that identifies policies and hardware issues that may be slowing down devices and then allows IT to take advantage or to take action proactively before users experience those issues themselves or have a chance to raise those tickets. So this is something that I'm really excited about, obviously, and it's something that's available to most Endpoint Manager customers right now. Like they can just go into to the Endpoint Manager Admin Center, go to Reports, Endpoint Analytics, and click a Start button, and it'll start collecting information on their cloud devices immediately. Now, if they happen to be Configuration Manager customers and they're on-premises, they can take advantage of Endpoint Analytics as well. All they need to do is tenant attach and follow a few steps that we've outlined in our product documentation. And they can then log into the Endpoint Manager console, click start, and then get data on their on-premises managed devices. And then finally, this Endpoint Analytics data feeds into a larger score that we call productivity score that will provide a more comprehensive view of the productivity within your organization.
For our viewers, you'll find the blog links that Mayank referenced in this interview down below in the description for additional reading about Endpoint Manager. Mayank, thanks so much for chatting with us today.
Thank you, Vivian. It was nice to be here.
Sounds like these updates are really helpful for admins as they support a growing workforce.
Yeah, it's really been amazing to just see how quickly these teams have worked together to create the tools we need while working from home and really help us from going crazy. So I appreciate it. And like Mayank just discussed in his interview, Endpoint Analytics is now generally available, and it also works with Productivity Score to give you a more comprehensive view of what productivity looks like in your organization.
As a refresher, Productivity Score focuses on two areas, the employee experience and the technology one. Now, the product will introduce three new categories.
First, there are two new employee experience categories on meetings and teamwork to help leaders understand best practices and technologies and find more inclusive ways for people to work together. These two employee experience categories will be available at the end of October when Productivity Score goes GA.
The third category is a technology experience called Microsoft 365 Apps Health, which provides insights into performance and currency to ensure critical apps are up to date, secure, and able to support employee workflows. This category is now available.
And finally, there's been a refresh to the Business Continuity Special Report in Productivity Score. This special report helps customers measure how the move to remote work has been in the last few months and whether productivity has been affected in their org.
The report now shows a 180-day view history, which will give customers more granular insight into their org's productivity. To learn more about Productivity Score while it's still in preview, we've added a link below. Productivity Score moved to general availability on October 29th.
Next up, we have a handful of security updates to share. Microsoft Defender is now inclusive of Microsoft 365 Defender for end-user environments and Azure Defender for cloud and hybrid infrastructures. This new offering prevents, detects, and responds to threats across endpoints, applications, cloud platforms, and more. To help organizations keep up with changing regulations around data protection, we're excited to announce the general availability of Compliance Manager.
This helps businesses by translating complex regulatory requirements into actions that can be carried out to simplify compliance. It also provides assessment templates that organizations can use to measure and reduce risk. Check out the description for additional reading about the type of assessment templates available and to learn more about Compliance Manager.
And lastly, to help you protect identities, apps, and services in the cloud and on-premises, we're announcing enhanced capabilities for Azure AD Application Proxy. So now, in addition to configuring single sign-on to legacy on-premise apps, you can now connect apps that use header-based authentication, one of the most popular legacy authentication protocols.
This update will be available in public preview at the end of October. To learn more about these updates, as well as the many security, compliance, and identity investments that came out of Ignite, check the blog post in the description. And finally, we're pleased to announce the new Outlook for Mac, which features a redesigned user experience and new updates to the Mail, Search, Calendar, and People features.
From thoughtful UI and UX elements that have been specifically crafted for the Mac, to MyDay integration to surface your agenda right next to your inbox, the latest Outlook for Mac updates really emphasize intuitive design and simplified tools to manage your email and calendar experience. These updates will be available for all users in October. To learn more about the latest redesign, go to aka.ms/Outlook for Mac 2020. We definitely covered a lot of ground for McKnight, but there's so much more that we haven't had a chance to talk about.
If you want to learn even more about this year's news and keynotes, check out all the links in the description below, which includes the Book of News, feature-specific blog posts, support pages, and so much more.
And if you haven't done so already, you can also check out the other Ignite videos on this channel that go into more detail about some of the biggest news to come out of the conference.
So what's your favorite feature to come out of Ignite this year? We want to hear your thoughts down below, and don't forget to like this episode while you're at it. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you all next month. Bye.
Bye.